Okay, welcome everybody.
Thank you.
Hope you're enjoying your morning so far. And a nice drive down the road. I thought the sun would have been out, I have to say, but it's not raining, that's the main thing. Now, do you want to know now who has won the prizes?
Yeah.
Or do you want to keep you in suspense? No, I'll not keep you in suspense. Right. So, the cow that produced the most milk this morning, she produced 31.2 litres. And her name is Ethel Super Sire 3150, sponsored by Stephen and Anne Topley. And she was closely followed in second place by a cow that gave 30 litres, and it was sponsored by Hazel Milliken. So it was a close run thing, but anyway, what have we got here?
I'll tell you what the prize is,
Wrong one. So, you make ice cream from milk, right? You make other things as well, cheese, etc., and yogurt. But so there's a voucher there for £20 for Graham's ice cream in Refreeland. So you can enjoy some ice cream today or another stage. Now, the cow that lifted his tail first, which I thought was a bit of fun, and I think it turned out to be a bit of fun. And that goes to, Jade 2, 3188. And that was sponsored by Nigel Traynor, who's part of FBC. I don't think Nigel's here this morning. But Nigel gets the prize, and I didn't know what to get for that, so I thought I'll get a P&G voucher for the beef counter in P&G. So that's who's won the prize for that side of things. So that was really good. If any of you owe me money for sponsorship, that's the envelope. Come and see me afterwards and we'll get that sorted. All the cows were sponsored. There was a few extra left over, so I reckon with at least £1,200, probably. So thank you so much for that. Now, I'm going to have a wee adventure to do for the kids later in a wee minute or two. But I want us all to join in. Have you all got the order of service?
Yes.
Okay. And can I say a big thank you to my dad, Craig, and my brother Peter and Alec and Archie for giving up their family farm for this morning. So give them a round of applause by way of thank you. Really appreciate that. Maybe you can see why most days this is my happy place. Sometimes frustrating place, you can get told off very, very easily, but it's mostly my happy place, and it really does bring me a lot of joy to help out here when I can. So we're going to begin with a short introduction, which will all become clear. So let's stand together before we sing. Then I saw, words from Revelation 5, then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll. Do not weep. Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying together, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. Amen. And the elders fell down and worshipped. Folks, that's going on right now. As we gather in the church that is God's creation, that's what's happening in heaven right now with a number that no man can number. That's why we're going to sing How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy path throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
thank you. bring light. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that's broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
For a second, for a time of confession, prayers. I just wrote out Psalm 51 there for us to use as our general confession. We'll just take a moment just to be still and enjoy the fresh air, perhaps our journey down. What has been, what we are going back home to this week, what has happened to us over the last couple of days. And none of that takes the Lord by surprise, of course. So we come to him as a father who knows everything that's going on. We say together, have mercy. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Father God, on this Sabbath morning, we pray for those who are bowed down by any kind of worry. We remember those who are sick at this time, remembering in particular Jamie. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are finishing off school this incoming week, for leavers in P7 who are moving in to a whole new sphere of life. For those who will have decisions to make this summer in terms of their future. For the parents and grandparents as they try to lead, guide with wisdom, grace and encouragement. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who have recently been bereaved. We pray in particular for the Marshall family, and the Coulter family. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, for the world in which we live, for the nations at war, rumors of war, for ongoing conflicts in Ukraine and Palestine, Father, may you, the God of all peace, who is sovereign over the whole world, who feeds the birds of the air, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Joining all our prayers together, we pray as Jesus himself taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, for all the boys and girls here, I've got a challenge for you during the sermon, but if you like. We're going to have a kids' song first, so I want you up to come up to the front if you would, and then I'm going to give you a challenge, because all the animals here in the yard, here, here, and in there, I'm going to give you a sheet with a number on them. That's the cow or the calf's number, and I want you to try and find that number, and then write down that calf's name, okay? which is the bottom one. I've got a wee sheet here for you so you can see that. If you need to take a mum or dad or a granny with you to help you, that's okay. When you go in there, don't go into the animals, because the cows might not like that, okay? They'll be surprised by that. So don't go in beyond the rails. I'll just have a look for them in the meantime. So can I have the boys and girls up just towards the front here for a minute or two, right? And this is a song called I'm Gonna Sing, Sing, Sing. Come on, Alec. Good man. Girl, Adria, good to see you. This is one of our P7 leavers. Stay in front of me here, just line up in front here, facing me. Okay, facing me. That's it. Now, we all can stand, and I'm going to try and do the actions with you. I'm going to sing, sing, sing. I'm going to shout, shout, shout. I'm going to sing, I'm going to shout to the Lord, okay? That's what we're going to try and do, okay? Your sheet. The cow's name that we're looking for is the bottom name. So there's a picture here to show you what I mean. The top name is the daddy. The bottom name is the mother. Okay? So on this side you have the number. I have pens here. And I don't think there's any in here from, I did this yesterday. I don't think there's any in there. But there's definitely some on both sides in there. Okay? Alec will go, he'll show you where to go. And there's definitely some from both sides in the heifer house, which is the one across the road, okay? So, come up and grab a sheet. Share them out amongst you. And grab a pen. Now, if any adults want to take part, feel free to do so. You'll hear me anyway, so. Pen doesn't work, come back and we'll get another one here, so hopefully they will. All right. Yeah. Everybody got one, yep. Good stuff. Now we're going to sing again. Well known hymn that we used when we were up in Enniskillen. Blessed Assurance. So let's stand together as we sing this.
Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine. And oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. And this is my story. Oh, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long, all the day long. Looking up.
Okay, sitting comfortably?
Yes.
That'll be bring the barbecue, you know. We're going to have meat in about an hour, probably. Right. So, some fun facts about cows. The average cow chews at least 50 times per minute. Just like ourselves, really. Number two, cows don't bite grass. Instead, they curl their tongue around clumps of grass, which they then pull and tear it into their mouths. So they don't actually bite it. Number three, a cow's sense of smell is much stronger than humans. They can pick up scents from as far away as 6 miles away. I didn't know this one now. Cows have the same number of teeth as adults, 32. Who knew? The average dairy cow, which you have seen today, produces approximately 55 liters of saliva per day. So that's 11, 2 liters. No, it's not, it's more, far more. 55 liters of saliva a day is produced by the average dairy cow. Cows have almost 360 degree vision, but they have trouble seeing straight on. So if you approach a cow right in front of it, quite often it'll tilt its head to see you. So it's no problem seeing pretty much 360. It can look right round and see whatever is going on, but slight problem straight on, but still very good. Apparently cows cannot see the colour red. They are red and green colourblind. This one you'll know, cows love routine. That's when it's time to be milked, they'll be ready waiting for us to go and get them. So that they know exactly what time of the day it is, when things should be done. And if it's not done, they'll stand and they'll eventually roar at you to say, right, what's happening here? The highest amount of milk ever produced by a single cow in a single year. Now, I find this hard to believe, but apparently it's true. The highest amount of milk ever produced by any cow in 1 year was approximately 27,000 litres by a Holstein cow, which we have here, named Robotham Sue Paddy. She's worth a lot of money, I would imagine. Cow's milk across the world accounts for 83% of the total milk production globally. Other animals contribute milk destined for human consumption, but the cow produces 83% of the world's milk. The water buffalo is second, which accounts for 13% of the world total. The most expensive cow ever sold. What do you think she was worth? This is in the Guinness Book of Records. She was sold in America for $4 million, £3,124,000. Her name is Fiatina 19 Vifmaran Movels and is recorded as the most expensive cow ever sold. Here in Northern Ireland, how much do you pay for 2 litres of milk? I'm coming to that, Dad, I'm coming to that. 165, right? As of this month, we here were paid 34p a litre base price. You get a wee bit extra when your milk quality is good, but 34p. So the 2 litres of milk that you pay 165 for, it costs, we get paid 68p. And we reckon it costs 40p a litre to produce. So at the minute, we don't get enough. So I'm crying here. I'm looking for a wee donation the way out, okay? Just to put it, so the creameries and the supermarkets, they're the ones that pretty much dictate all of that, and they're the ones that get probably the most profit out of it. What does it say about cows in the Bible? So I had to do a lot of research this past week or 10 days. Does anybody know where the first mention of a cow is in the Bible, or a heifer, which is a baby cow basically? You should know this, because this is something that I've taught you for as long as I've been here. It's in Genesis 15. You know when the Lord cuts his covenant with Abram in Genesis 15? We read, "So the Lord said to Abram, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon." And so the cow is used in the ceremony of the cutting of the covenant, which goes all the way forward to ultimately Jesus being cut in two, basically, to fulfill God's promise that if there's any more dying to be done, then I'll do it. And that was fulfilled on the cross. So the cow, or the heifer in this case, was the most valuable thing in that ceremony. And there's a way to remember this, A, B, C, and D. So A is for Abram. No. First mention of a cow in the scriptures. The second mention is B for bounty, because in Exodus 13, when the Lord speaks about the promised land, he describes the promised land as what? Land flowing with milk and honey. And it's a beautiful graphic description of the agricultural richness of the land of Israel. And since milk accounts for 83% of the global milk that's drank by humans, in many areas in Israel, it is extremely fertile. The area north of present-day Israel, which was known as biblical Mesopotamia, also known as the Fertile Crescent, is exactly that. It's extremely fertile. So the land of Israel, it really is a land flowing with milk and honey. So A is for Abram, B is for bounty, C is for carts. Now, not goat carts. We read in 1 Samuel chapter 6, when the Philistines stole the Ark of the Covenant, if you remember, they brought it to their own city, and bad things started to happen. So they saw that these bad things were a result of the Ark of the Covenant, which they had stolen. So they wanted to send it back to the Israelites. And this is how they went about it. "Now then, take and prepare a new cart and two milk cows on it, which they have never been yoked, and yoke the cows to the cart, but take their calves home away from them," which is what they did. Verse 10. "The men did so and took two milk cows and yoked them to the cart and shut up their calves at home. And the cow," I love this, "and the cows went straight in the direction of Beth Shemesh along one highway, lowing as they went. They turned neither to the right nor to the left." Now, if that had been a sheep, they'd been straight through the first hole, the ark and the cart would have been wrecked. But not with cows. Cows are the best. Verse 13. But there was a sad end to the cows. "Now the people of Beth Shemesh were reaping their wheat harvest in the valley. And when they lifted up their eyes and saw the ark, they rejoiced to see it. The ark came into the field of Joshua of Beth Shemesh and stopped there. A great stone was there. And they split up the wood of the cart and offered the cows as a burnt offering to the Lord." Poor cows. They'd done their job and then they were sacrificed. So A is for Abram, first mention of a heifer in the Old Testament. B is for the bounty of the land of flowing with milk and honey. C is the two cows that were yoked to the carts. And then D is dreams. Does anybody know what that might mean? Dreams in the Old Testament that involves cows. Exodus? No. Before Exodus, Genesis. Genesis 41, Pharaoh's dreams. You remember this. When 2 full years had passed, Pharaoh had a dream. He was standing by the Nile when out of the river came up 7 cows, sleek and fat, and they grazed among the reeds. After them, 7 other cows, ugly and gaunt, came up out of the Nile and stood beside those on the riverbank. And the cows that were ugly and gaunt ate up the seven sleek, fat cows. Then Pharaoh woke up. So if you remember, nobody in Egypt could interpret Pharaoh's dream. And Joseph was remembered by someone in the palace who could interpret dreams. And so Joseph is summoned to Pharaoh. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, "The dreams of Pharaoh are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do." And then Joseph tells Pharaoh that the seven fat cows represent 7 years of plenty, because then they are to prepare for the salmon 7 years of famine that will follow. And God could have used any animal for that, but he used cows, because in Egypt at that time, the Egyptians worshipped Hathor, who was a cow goddess. And so God used cows to speak to Pharaoh because it was something he was familiar with. And to say, you may think Hathor is in charge of all these events, but she is not. I am the Lord of heaven and earth, and I'm going to bring 7 years of prosperity, and then I'm going to bring 7 years of famine. And there's nothing any of your gods can do about it. So A is for who? B, C, D. Very good. Go to the top of the class. Now, I want to leave you with this thought today. And it came from an experience I had here. Well, not here, but started here in the farm on Tuesday. But before I tell you about that, I want to read to you from 1 Samuel 16, passage you know very well. And it actually contains a cow, which I forgot about until I started to prepare it. So Saul is dead, and the people of Israel want a new king. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul, since I have rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be in your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king." But Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me." The Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord." So Samuel has to take a heifer, which is a young cow. And what was the heifer used for? What was the significance of it? In Deuteronomy chapter 21, God instructed that a heifer had to be sacrificed to atone for the sins of someone who had died in the land where the people lived. So, in Deuteronomy 21, a man's body had been found dead. And the Lord said, whatever has happened to this man, an atonement has to be made. And so a heifer was the designated animal used to atone for the sin of that land. And so before a new king could be found and anointed, a sacrifice had to be made, and the choice of the sacrifice was a heifer, because it was an extremely valuable animal. Verse 3, "Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. You are to anoint for me the one I indicate." Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, "Do you come in peace?" Samuel replied, "Yes, in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." On Tuesday, we as a farm had animals to sell to bring to the market. We took them to Market Hill. And that meant a lot of preparation. And it started here with the cows being groomed, their head and all being shaved nicely, tails shaved, looking their best. And then Peter had to start and wash them, the heifers that had been milking. And they were washed spotlessly clean. And then the animals were lifted in the lorry here. We had to go three times, and they were taken to Market Hill. And by the time they got to Market Hill, they'd obviously had the tail lifted a few times. So when they arrived at Market Hill, they had to be washed again, but only rinsed down. But the steam cleaning, which was done here, was taking all the hard muck off them, and they were looking amazing. And whenever I arrived at Market Hill, all the animals had arrived, and they were looking brilliant. And for some farmers, the look of the cow is enough. It's like, that's it. You get a trained eye. I don't have a trained eye yet, but farmers have a trained eye for these things. Now, this farm here have Holstein cows, pedigree Holstein cows. And Peter knows where every cow has come from. He knows their ancestry. And when each cow was brought into the ring to be sold, some farmers just would have thought, I want to buy that cow because it looks amazing. But the more pedigree prone farmers were listening when Peter introduced each cow in the ring. He was able to tell them the daddy, the bull's name. Each cow here is classified by Holstein UK. So Peter was able to say this is a 94 very good, or a 93 excellent, or if it's just really good, it's a 94 excellent. So they're graded, and the higher the grade and the higher the value, good, very good or excellent, the more the value goes up. Peter is also able to tell the prospective buyers about the quality of the milk that cow produces in terms of protein and butter fat. So our milk is tested every day with the milk lorry that you saw. A sample is taken, and that goes to the milk producer, the creamery. And they're able to tell us the percentage of butter fat and protein in that sample. And we are very lucky and blessed and all that, in that our cows are good cows and they produce a high quality of protein and butter fat. So when the farmers were going to buy that cow, the value of the cow really wasn't on the outside, it was on the inside. And you can imagine me as a preacher sitting there watching all of this take place. That the value of the cow is on the inside. What about the value of a human being? And here in 1 Samuel, when the Lord is directing Samuel to his choice of a new king, he said to Samuel, the Lord does not look on the outside, he looks on the inside. And I'm sure many of us struggle with how we look on the outside when we compare ourselves to whoever. None of us have come out of that looking very well. But here's the thing, God does not look on your appearance on the outside and value you on how you look on the, and I'm sure you're glad like me that he doesn't do that. He looks on the inside. A pig was lamenting his lack of popularity. He complained to a cow that people were always talking about the cow's gentleness and kind eyes. He admitted that cows give milk and cream, but maintained that pigs give more. He asserted that pigs give bacon and ham and bristles, and that people even pickle their feet. He demanded a reason for such lack of appreciation. The cow thought for a while and then said, maybe it's because I give while I'm still alive. Folks, God is looking for disciples and people who will give while they're still alive. No matter what you look like or think about yourself or view yourself on the outside, or indeed even on the inside. No one has diagnosed humanity better than the Lord Jesus. And in Mark chapter 7, the Pharisees are giving Jesus' disciples a hard time because they didn't wash their hands before the meal, which was part of Judaistic ceremony. So because they hadn't washed their hands and was part of their tradition to do so, they were labeled as being unclean. So something that they did on the outside of their bodies, the Pharisees said, you're unclean. And Jesus diagnoses the human condition. He said, what comes out of a person is what defiles them. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and make a person unclean. The story is told in the 1900s in the Times newspaper. Different people posed the question, what's wrong with the world today? And they wrote out to many well-known philosophers and theologians at the time. And the well-known author G.K. Chesterton, who has a tremendous way with words, he responded in a letter, and it was one very short sentence. He said, dear sir, I am. That's all he said. One commentator summed it up, the heart of the human problem is the problem of the human heart. And Jesus is the only one who can clean our hearts from the inside out. And while the Pharisees were saying, what you do on the outside, what makes you unacceptable to God, Jesus said, no, it's on the inside. And when I come and be your Savior and come and live on the inside, I start to clean up the inside. So that in the way that cows give when they're living, you and I can start to give to God, because one of the changes that he makes is the fruit of the Spirit, which is what God begins to do on the inside, comes out. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, I don't worry you've ever called anybody a nosy cow, have you? Hopefully today you realize where that phrase comes from, because cows are extremely nosy. They will come to see what's going on, and that's why I love them. Now, I don't want any of you to call anybody a nosy cow, but what I would love you to be able to do is to call someone a spiritual cow and encourage them to give to God while you're still alive. Today, every one of us here, Rector included, is called to be, if you like, a spiritual cow that gives while we're still alive, so that his kingdom would come more and more day by day in your world and in mine. So that's the challenge and the invitation that I give to all of us this morning. Can we be cleaned on the inside? Because God looks on the inside. The shrewd farmer listens to see what this cow can give on the inside. It's not deceived by how well it looks on the outside, because that'll change in a few months' time before it gives birth. And then it'll come back into its best looking cow again when it starts to give milk. But we can be people who give 24/7, because Jesus wants to come and live on the inside and change us from the inside out. Now, boys and girls, have you finished? Right, do you want the answers? Okay, you can stay where you are, you come up the front. I've no prize for this, by the way. This is just a bit of fun. I know, I've meant to do that on the way home and I forgot on the way up here. How'd you get on, Archie? Did I make a mistake? You crossed the one that I messed up out. That's good. Good man, Archie. I knew you'd work that out. So, here's the answers. You tick them off, right? 31:32 is Revelation. Yep. You all got it? Yep. 32:67 is called Lassie. 33:58 is called Natasha. 33:72 is called Janice. Yeah. 34:47 is called Squaw. 34:58 is called Heidi. 34:60 is called Susan. 34:61 is called Alice. 34:72 is called Marlene. 34:79 is called Mandy. 34:80 is called Lindsay. Diamonds? Is that the one I got wrong, Archie?
No.
No? I'll trust your judgment. 34:84 is Starlight. 34:86 is Lynn. 34:90 is Ethel. And 34:80, is this the one I got wrong? 35:80 meant. Is that, and it's called Chef. Chef, am I right?
Am I not?
What's it called? Nothing. It's called Chef. What? I'm not sure. I think it's a dried off cow, is it, Peter? 35:80. Oh, there is no 35:80. You were right. You were right. Where did I get 35:80? I must have put the number down wrong. So, did you all get them right apart from 35:80?
Yes.
Silence. Yes.
Yes. Well done. Well done.
So, what's 34:80?
It doesn't exist, apparently. So 34:80 is diamonds. Yes.
Yeah, I got
it. Now, is there any Rice Krispie buns left? Right. Your mummy brought Rice Krispie buns, didn't she? Did you make them? Well, how about you take them all over there and let them have a Rice Krispie bun for doing so well? And we'll all give you a cheer as you go. Well done. Just leave your pens here and I'll gather them up in a wee minute. Amanda, thank you for making the tea, and Wendy as well, is that right? Thank you. Do you want to make any more? No? What? Well, there's plenty of hot water. Peter, to keep you right, or Alec. Alec, I'll show you where the hot water is. There's, and there's kettles in there, we'll keep you right. Alec, show Amanda where the hot water comes out of the knob over in the corner, which you put into the kettles. Now, we're not kicking you out. Peter, whenever you all nearly leave, we'll start to feed. So if you're wondering, the tractor to my right, the first one, the slightly smaller one, has got what's called the dad feeder on it. So we put straw and silage and meal, and we mix all that up, and then it comes out each side and up and down the feeding passages here. So the cows will come in and they'll start eating over here. It'll be ready for them. And on the left hand side, as we look in here now, you'll see they don't have much left. So they'll be getting fed in the next hour or so. So whenever we arrive on a morning, we obviously do the milking, feeding next, and it's fairly straightforward, so I don't have to use a grape very often, just to clean out. So thank you for coming. We're going to stand and sing one final song called the Doxology, which is the blessing. So would you all please stand?
Thank you.
Enjoyed yourselves. Safe home. We will finish off these bickies and get a mouthful of tea before we head back. If you need to go, then feel free to do so. If you need the loo before you go, up to Peter's house in through the back door on the left hand side, and you'll find a toilet in there for you, okay? Thank you. Safe home. God bless.